it led to spread of diseases. You can write a lot of points, okay? So from your imagination also you can write, because this is going to be a very general question, but this two, which was given by Gandhi, that's why I have discussed this two point. Deindustrialization is very important, okay? And in this, connected India is very important. So whatever you feel like, whatever you want, or whatever you come across, you can write all those points. There is no issue at all. Okay, next is in 1853, the first post and telegraph services started, okay? Post and telegraph services started. So, Dalhousie started post and telegraph service, okay? So, it was between Calcutta to Agra, okay? So, between Calcutta to Agra. Now, again, in 1854, the Indian post and telegraph service started, okay? So, Indian post and telegraph services started in 1854. So, the point is, post and telegraph was introduced in 1853, Act was in 1854. If you remember, in 1773 Regulating Act, I told you, there was a provision of establishment of Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court was established in 74. But here, the post and telegraph services started in 53 and Act was in 54, okay? So keep in mind this difference. Now, another very important point that I need to discuss under Lord Dalhousie is, in 1854, something which is very important happened related to education, okay? So you might be understood what I'm going to discuss now. So the point is something related to education, and that's what we call as Wood's Dispatch. So it was actually named after Charles Wood, who was the president of Board of Control, which is sitting in England. So if you remember, we have discussed about this Board of Control when we discussed about 1784 Pitt's India Act, okay? So a Board of Control was established in England with 6 members to regulate the affairs of East India Company, and the then president of Board of Control was Charles Wood, okay? Now, you can see after some times this Board of Control, this will be abolished and instead Secretary of State post will be created, okay? So then the first secretary will be Charles Wood again, because he was the then president of Board of Control, okay? So all those things we'll be discussing later. But here the point is, Charles Wood, who was the president of Board of Control, wrote a letter to the Governor General by suggesting certain reforms in education, and that's what we call as Wood's Dispatch. Okay, so we need to see Wood's Dispatch in detail. Now, before we discuss about Wood's Dispatch, let's go for a recap of what we have discussed till now related to education. Okay, so we have discussed something related to education in 1813. So 1813 Charter Act, the first such effort related to education happened, that the company was directed to spend rupees 1 lakh for the purpose of betterment of education, okay, in those areas where they have control in, right? Then after that, we have seen in 1835, during this time, there was a debate which is going on between Anglicist and Orientalist, and Anglicist won the debate, and they have decided that the Indians will get education in English model and in English medium. So they have decided that they are going to give education in English model and in English medium. That's a higher education, okay? So they have given importance to higher education, and that's what Maculaminate. And Maculaminate is what we call as trickle-down theory or downward filtration theory, etc., right? But it did not benefited the masses, because they are focusing on higher education and a minority of Indians, right? The assumption is this 1% of the Indians who's getting education in English model and in English medium will teach rest of the others in Indian model, right? Or vernacular language. That's the idea, okay? But it was a failure. Now, what happened is, in 1854, Wood's Dispatch is what we need to discuss, how the problem of Maculaminate is solved. This is what Maculaminate, right? Or trickle-down theory or downward filtration theory. As a solution to that, what Wood's Dispatch did. Let's look at the provision, okay? So the first point and the most important point is, education for all, or education for masses, is now the responsibility of the state. Earlier, Maculaminate, education for few and minority. You educate few, that few will educate rest of the others in vernacular language. Trickle down theory or downward filtration theory was the assumption, to create a group which will act as a middleman between English and the local Indians, right? But here, education for all and education for masses is now the responsibility of the state. So you can see this is a drastic change, right? At least state took up the responsibility now. So many scholars call it as Magna Carta of modern Indian education, okay? So Magna Carta is actually a famous order issued by the English king way back in 1215, which granted certain rights to the citizen. So they compared this Woods dispatched with that, okay? So education for all or education for masses, and that's the most important point, okay? Education is not for the elected or selected few, it's for masses. And the second point, if you see, secondary education should be given in vernacular language, okay? And higher education should be in English. So higher education should be in English, already decided during Macmillan Minute. So we have told already that they have given importance for higher education. Now you can see they are giving importance to secondary education also. But even now, the problem is primary education, nobody is taking care. Even in Macmillan Minute, they are not mentioning about primary education. Here also, they are not talking about primary education. So they have given importance for secondary education. In Macmillan Minute, higher education is given importance. Here, secondary education is given importance. Okay. So first point is education for masses. Second point, education. The secondary education should be in vernacular language. Higher education should be in English language. Third point is actually technological colleges has to be set up. Okay. So technological colleges has to be set up. Okay. And you can see in 1854 at Roorkee, the first engineering college was set up. Okay. So first engineering college was set up at Roorkee in 1854, and now it was converted to IIT during Vajpayee time. Okay. Then again, if you look at in 1854 in Bihar, okay, so first engineering college was in Roorkee. Now in Bihar, Pusa Institute of Agricultural Sciences, was established, okay, so in Bihar. But in 1934, due to an earthquake, it was shifted to Delhi. Okay, so originally Pusa Institute of Agricultural Sciences was established in Bihar in 1854. It was shifted to Delhi in 1934 due to earthquake. Okay, the next point is again very important, fourth point, that universities to be opened. Okay, so universities to be opened for higher education. See, till then there was no concept of degree that you're getting now, right? No degree, no post graduation, etc., like BCom, MCom, BA, etc. There was no such concept. Okay, there was madrasa education on one side, gurukul education on the other side, and we have seen the problems associated with that also. There was no such concept of the graduation or post graduation, etc. Okay, now universities to be opened. Okay, and you can see in 1857, see, the Woods dispatch was in 1854. Again, you need to remember this. 1857, three universities were established at Madras, Calcutta and Bombay. Okay, so three universities in three presidencies, very important. Later when we discuss about during 1860s and 1870s, nationalism was emerging, and one of the most important reason is this establishment of universities in Bombay, Calcutta and Madras, three presidencies. Okay, next, fifth point is teachers training programs to be started, right? It's not only the student who need to be taught, the teachers also to be taught in the way that they are going to teach the student. Okay, so this is actually the beginning of the present day B.Ed. programs, etc. Okay, so if you look at Woods dispatch, these are the five points that you need to be very careful. So one is education for all or education for masses is now the responsibility of the state. The state took up the responsibility, and the problem of Macmillan Minute is solved. Okay, Macmillan Minute was based on the assumption of trickle down theory. Okay, so here we are going to give education for masses. Second point, secondary education is given importance, and secondary education should be in vernacular language, and higher education should be in English. That is already decided in Macmillan Minute. Okay, third point, technological colleges to be started, and you can see in 1854 two technological colleges, one in Roorkee, that was the first engineering college, then in Bihar, that was Pusa Institute of Agricultural Sciences. Then universities to be opened, three universities in Calcutta, Bombay and Madras was established or opened in 1857, then teachers training program. So these are the five provisions that you need to remember from Woods dispatch. Okay, now in 1854 you can see PWD started, Public Works Department started. Okay, so the objective was basically to construct roads, canals, bridges, dams, etc. Okay, now it is known for many bad reasons, but this was one of the most important point that you need to remember. PWD started, Public Work Department started, and this acted as developmental tool. Okay, so roads, canals, bridges, dams, etc. were building, that was the objective of this. Okay, and you can see Dalhousie developed a lot of hill stations. Okay, so Dalhousie developed a lot of hill station, this Mussoorie, Nainital, Shimla, Kullu, Manali, etc. So very important. And now Shimla is known as summer capital of British. Okay, Shimla is known as Shimla is known as summer capital of British, and Dalhousie in itself is a city. Okay, so all these things happened during Dalhousie time. So he developed a lot of hill station. He established a public work department. Another important point is during 1855-56 time, there was a powerful rebellion which is going on in the eastern part of India. We call it a Santal rebellion. Okay, so Santal rebellion. Now who are Santals? Santals are a tribal group, okay, who are living mostly in modern day Jharkhand, formerly in Bihar, in an area called as Rajmahal Hills, okay. So Rajmahal Hills. So Santals is a tribal group. So when you talk about Santal rebellion, it's a tribal rebellion. They were living in Rajmahal Hills in Bihar. Now what happened? What is the actual reason? See, during this time, many zamindars and many mahajans from cities, they started entering into the area of Santals, and also many contractors, okay, because we already discussed about PWD. So for development of railways, to cut the trees, okay, to develop dams, etc., many contractors started entering into their areas. Basically many outsiders started entering into their areas. So they call these outsiders as Diku. And for them, it hardly matters whether you are an Indian or an English. So you can be an Indian. So a lot of English people also used to go in their area. Indians like zamindars, mahajans and contractors also used to go to their area. So they commonly call the outsiders as Dikus. So Santal rebellion was a rebellion between Santals and Dikus, means Santals and outsiders. That outsiders include both Indian and English. Okay, now what is the reason these outsiders, they went to their area, they started grabbing their agricultural land, grazing land, etc., and they started exploiting the tribal women. So all this created a lot of issues, and the tribal started fighting against the outsiders or Dikus, and that's what Santal rebellion. So because of the entry of zamindars, Santals were actually subjected to very high rate of taxation, and at the same time they started losing the land also due to this money lenders who's charging very high rate of interest. So a new socio-political or economic situation emerged during that time in those areas, and that is in fact the reason for the present day the Maoism, Naxalism, etc. during the 60s. Okay, so all these are actually connected. We'll come to that when we discuss about those areas, but the point is Santals were exploited, so they started fighting against Dikus, and that's what Santal rebellion. And the two people who led the movement were Sidhu and Kanu. Sidhu and Kanu. Okay, so two brothers, Sidhu and Kanu, led the movement. So these people started killing the outsiders. Okay, so obviously when you are fighting against state is in an advantageous position, and this movement is suppressed or crushed completely by the state. Okay, but this was one of the initial tribal movement which motivated the future tribal movements. Okay, you can see a lot of tribal uprising later. We'll be discussing that in a separate module as a separate chapter. All the tribal uprisings we'll discuss together. Okay, next important point that we need to discuss during Dalhousie time was in 1856 Widow Remarriage Act. Okay, so I told you already during British time there were a lot of positive reforms. We have discussed about Lord William Bentinck, Anti-Sati Resolution, now Widow Remarriage Act, and all these actually required the support of the society. But the society was very orthodox, and they have seen all these reforms with great suspicion. They thought Britishers are unnecessarily interfering in their religion. So they could not implement these reforms properly in India because they didn't get any support from the local or the society. And when we discussed about Anti-Sati Resolution, I told you Lord William Bentinck was the Governor General who passed the resolution, but Rajaram Mohan Roy was the Indian who was responsible for that. Here also you can see Lord Dalhousie is the person who started this or implemented this Widow Remarriage Act, but the Indian who was responsible for this or who worked for this is Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. Okay, so the Indian who was worked for this Widow Remarriage is Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. Now when Dalhousie was about to draft this law, Widow Remarriage Act, a lot of Hindu upper caste people, the Brahmins, approached Dalhousie or started writing letters to Dalhousie not to do such kinds of reform, not to touch their religion. Okay, and you can see all this culminated into 1857 revolt later. See, one thing is already we have discussed during Lord Cornwallis' time, they have introduced equality before law. See, at least among the Indians, they introduced equality, right? So, see, female widow is not allowed to remarry, but a male widow can remarry. That means there is a discrimination, right? They introduce Widow Remarriage Act, okay? So, if you see an interesting thing, even Bal Gangadhar Tilak was against this law. See, you see certain leaders like Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Mahatma Gandhi, etc. They were politically very, very modern. But socially they were very orthodox, and this paradox you can see even nowadays also in some leaders. Okay, socially very orthodox but politically modern. Okay, now next point that I need to discuss under Lord Dalhousie is in 1856. Okay, that is annexation of Awadh. Annexation of Awadh. See, we have discussed about many annexations. We have discussed about annexation of Punjab just before, after second Anglo-Punjab war. Before that we have discussed about annexation of Sindh in 1843, right? So here they started annexing more and more areas, especially after, you know, Lord Hastings' times. During that time they changed their policy, they started extending their territory, right? Because of two reasons, market and raw material, because of 1813 Charter Act. Okay, all those things you have discussed, so you can connect everything. So annexation of Awadh. So this was the most controversial annexation among all, even controversial than you know, doctrine of lapse, because they annexed Awadh on the reason of misgovernance. Okay, so they have no other reason to give, misgovernance. And in fact, Awadh was one of the state who signed subsidiary alliance earlier. So under subsidiary alliance, Britishers are actually promising you that they will protect you from any external threat and they will not interfere in the internal matters, and they are breaking their promise. Okay, so it's very controversial. The Nawab of Awadh at that time was Wajid Ali Shah. Okay, Wajid Ali Shah. So British accused him of misgovernance and annexed Awadh. Okay, but the point is, this was not acceptable to the masses, because Awadh was one of the peaceful and prosperous state at that time. And people of Awadh were relatively much, much better politically or economically or financially or socially in all dimensions compared to other states. And their culture is very famous also. Lucknowi culture is very famous. So this misgovernance, the way the king was accused of misgovernance, it was not digested for the masses. Okay, so there was huge unrest, you can see. And if you observe one more thing, majority of the soldiers of the Bengal army is actually from Awadh. So they have a sympathy with the ruler. So sympathy with the ruler, and you can say this is also one of the reason for 1857 revolt. So majority of the soldiers of Bengal army are from Awadh, and they have a great sympathy towards the ruler, because it was not true. The way the king was accused is not true. Another reason why they participated in 1857 revolt, if you see, that can be economic also. Sympathy will not last for long, right? See, the moment Awadh was annexed, what happened? Awadh will come under English, British India, right? So Awadh will come under permanent settlement. We have discussed in detail about that, or zamindari settlement. So most of the farmers now have to pay much, much more money as the tax. Earlier you are paying some amount as tax and you used to get benefit from the Nawab, but now you need to pay a lot. There is an exploitation of zamindars and you are not getting any benefit from the state. And I told you already, most of the soldiers are from Awadh. Okay, so their parents or the father is a peasant. So in fact, most of the peasant are actually farmers who are from Awadh, and they are even called as farmers in uniform. So the moment Awadh come under permanent settlement, you need to pay more tax. So that actually affected, or you can say this sympathy, maybe because of that, okay, because of this economic situation. So that is the reason why the soldiers are fighting, okay, 1857 revolt. One of the reason of 1857 revolt, when we discuss political reason, I'll tell you annexation of Awadh, okay. Because on one side, the Begum was also fighting, but if you see from soldiers' side, they have a sympathy towards the ruler. At the same time, they have to pay very high rate of tax. So this is what? Annexation of Awadh. So if you see what all things we have discussed, why Dalhousie is important, because we started off with the doctrine of lapse, very important. We understood three categories of state. The states which were neither part of Mughals nor Marathas nor paying tax to them, the doctrine of lapse was not applicable to them. Then we have seen the states which were either part of Mughals or Marathas or paying tax to them, they have to write a letter to the Governor General, so doctrine of lapse is not applicable there also. Third category, the states which were created under British Charter, doctrine of lapse is only applicable there. And we have seen the states which are annexed, okay. Then we have seen second Anglo-Punjab War, okay. Then we have seen railways, 1853, railways was introduced, okay. Then we have seen 1853 Post and Telegraph Service and Post and Telegraph Service Act was in 1854. Then in 1854 we have seen Wood's Dispatch, very important, 5 points. First one, education for masses. Second point, secondary education should be in vernacular language. Higher education should be in English. Third point, technological colleges to be established. And we have seen in Roorkee First Engineering College and in Bihar Pusa Institute of Agricultural Sciences. Then fourth point, universities to be opened, and we have seen in 1857 three universities, Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. Then finally teachers training program. Okay, then we have seen PWD started. Okay, then we have seen a lot of hill stations were established or developed. Then we have seen Widow Remarriage Act. Okay, then we have seen Santal Rebellion. Okay, then we have seen annexation of Awadh. Okay, so all these are happened during Dalhousie time. So very, very eventful time. A lot of points that you need to remember. So if you get a question on Dalhousie, I hope you will be in a position to answer in a much better way.